Robots, I used to know the code to make you overload and cry. Someone came and turned you off, and you never told me why. But do you
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to show you a little video around the Innsbruck airport in Austria. This airport is very well known among FlightGear users because it's one of the best models in the whole world scenery. It has a lot of very nice 3D models of the various buildings and objects around the airport, and also the mountains around are very, very beautiful. To fly around. So that's why I chose this airport, but contrary to, let's say, what is more usual, I'm going to do this flight in helicopter, so you can get some idea of how it feels to fly in a helicopter in flight gear at least. And you'll see the sensations are quite different from what you can get with a plane. And I hope you'll enjoy this and want to try yourself afterwards. I'm going to explain a bit my setup for flying helicopters in flight gear, which is not using rudder pedals and expensive stuff, but only a cheap joystick, a used one, and a mouse. And I'll explain how I do that and show you a bit of the movements you can do with a helicopter you can't absolutely do with a plane, like stationary flying in front of an object, or rising up in the air without any horizontal speed, or rising this way while yawing. Very nice movements that are pleasant to see, I hope, for you. They are for me at least. So I hope I'm absolutely not a trained pilot or aircraft developer in flight gear. I'm just an enthusiast and want to share this pleasure with you and give you maybe the wish to try it by yourself. So the helicopter we are going to do this with is a Eurocopter EC130. Eurocopter is now a company called Airbus Helicopters. And it has a very nice flight model. Despite a few crashes from time to time, it's a pretty pleasant helicopter to fly. I'm going to use auto start in this video and auto shutdown, but normally you can't do that in the default configuration. You have to follow to do manual start, but the tutorial explains this very well. Maybe I post a video with the tutorial, but it's a very, very easy to follow. And once you've done 15 successful flights with the takeoff and landing instead of crash, you can use auto starts. Maybe it's not very easy for beginners because you have to do many attempts at first to fly correctly, and the auto start can be helpful here. But that's the developer's decision, so I respect it. But if you really, really have problems with that, let's say that you can have a look in FGHome in the file where helicopter data is stored, and maybe find the number of successful flights you've done stored there, and enable the auto start yourself. Anyway, before talking too much, let's go with the helicopter start top and QNH setting and all that. Let's connect the external power unit, then engage the helicopter auto start routine. Then we can check the weather conditions. So wind is coming mainly from 040 at 6 knots with variable direction, and QNH is 1021. We can use this QNH value to set the altimeter. As you can see, the altimeter tooltip displays the QNH in two different units, first inches of mercury, then hectopascals. You have to be aware that the value in hectopascals is obtained after some rounding to the nearest unit, so it's not as accurate as the value in inches of mercury for this helicopter, which natively works with inches of mercury. So that may explain differences in the altitude shown by the altimeter and what you could expect after reading the airport chart. So now engine is starting up, and we can use the twist grip with the Alt-T keyboard shortcut to bring the engine to full power. So the twist grip, as its names indicate, is a lever located on the right of the pilot that has to be twisted by the right hand. You can see it now on the image. It's in the center of the helicopter, right of the pilot. So normally you would twist it with your right hand. In FlightGear you can click on it with the left mouse button, or you can, I believe, middle mouse button drag towards the upwards direction. However, I don't use this method because I use the middle mouse button for other things. Anyway, now we can slowly increase collective, which is the helicopter control that allows you to climb. So with the keyboard that would be page down, as if you were reducing the throttle in a plane. While increasing the collective progressively, slowly, the very important thing to do when you're starting with helicopters and don't know really how to take off properly is to watch every movement the helicopter is making, in particular horizontal movements, and try to compensate them. So if you're very careful, compensating every tiny horizontal movement while slowly increasing collective, you're improving your chances of making a decent takeoff. This is a tip I found on the FlightGear wiki before I started with helicopters, and it was most helpful for me. So since helicopters are a bit hard at first, more difficult than planes, I suggest you try this if you try a helicopter. Okay, so we are now airborne, visiting a bit the airport. You can admire the runway, everything. Yes, I wanted to say that if you don't feel worried if you didn't follow the startup procedure of the helicopter, because this is not the purpose of this video. You can go to the help menu, choose tutorials, and when flying this helicopter, and you will have a step-by-step explanation of everything you need to do in order to start this helicopter. It's very easy to follow, so don't worry if you didn't understand everything I did to start the helicopter. You are not expected to learn this from this video. This video is just to give you the wish to try helicopter and a few tips as for how to control with mouse, joysticks, etc. So we are going above Flughafen Innsbruck, which I believe means Innsbruck Airport. As you can see, scenery is pretty nice. I'm going to have a look at the little FlightGear posters they put on the wall. I wouldn't swear these posters exist on the real airport at this place, but it's always nice and fun to see them. www.flightgear.org. Demonstrating at the same time a bit of stationary flight with slow translation to the left in order to see both posters. And then we are going to turn around using the tail rotor in order to face the control tower and say the ATC operator up there hello. for fun. Of course, you would never do that in a real airport, and similarly in flight gear, if you are on the multiplayer network, if you are connected to multiplayer, and if there is an ATC session where ATC means air traffic control, then you wouldn't behave this way either, because that would disturb the ATC session considerably. So how do you know there is an ATC session? It's simple. One of the easiest ways is to load the FlightGear multiplayer map in a web browser. So you can Google a FlightGear multiplayer map, or you can find it on the FlightGear wiki. And then at the airport you are situated, you look if there is a red eye. If there is a red eye, it means there is a control tower, and then you shouldn't fly so freely as I'm doing now over any airports. In fact, if you're closer than 80 nautical miles from a controlled airport, an airport where there is a control tower, you should just obey the instructions of the ATC operator. So for this you should have a voice communication software such as Mumble. The person tells you instructions, you repeat them to make sure the ATC so that the ATC operator can be sure you have understood the instructions correctly, and then you execute the instructions. That's mostly how it works. So now we are going to make a little amusing landing in the airport, right in front of the gate. So we have walls on the left, tree on the right, gate in front of us, so we better not make too many undesirable moves, otherwise we're going to crash. While I'm doing this, I'm going to explain a few more things about how this video was taken. So I'm using live recording, which means the recording software, in my case Simple Screen Recorder, is encoding the video exactly at the same time as I am flying. So this is slowing down the computer, and the frame rate is lower than what I usually have in comparable conditions because of this video encoding simultaneous to the flight. In order to be able to decently fly and to offer you a video that is pleasant to watch, I had to reduce the resolution and to reduce also the level of details, the rendering options in FlightGear. So this video is in rather low resolution. It's 1280 by 720, whereas I usually use HD resolution, 1920 by 1080. So I have reduced the resolution and rendering options, so it's not the most beautiful scenery you could expect from FlightGear, but at least it's reasonably fluid, and I can fly without too many difficulties. Yes, because if you have a frame rate that is lower than approximately 8 frames per second, it's very difficult to control the helicopter. It's easier with a plane, but with helicopters you need frame rate between at least 10 or 15 to be able to control it decently. You can see the frame rate in the lower right corner of the screen. This can be activated in the view options of the FlightGear menu. So, getting to a safer place, far from the gate and far from the walls, the buildings. Yes, I wanted to say, so I said this video was taken with a live recording, so this has some impacts as I just explained, impacts on frame rate, but it has several advantages, which is why I did this way. The advantages compared to the other solution are the following. First, everything is working properly, like the instrument panel. You can watch the instruments in the video, they are functioning normally, because it's exactly what I'm seeing when flying. And second, the flight path and the helicopter movements you are seeing are faithful to what I'm seeing myself. It is the correct flight path and correct rotations performed by the helicopter during my flight. Whereas the other popular solution to record a video, a flight gear video, which is to save the flight and then replay it at slow speed, record this replay at slow speed, and then use an external software to accelerate the video to recover the normal speed of the flight. This second method has the corresponding drawbacks to what I said previously, which, that is, if you using this, if you use this method by filming a replay, replay flight, then you have with most aircrafts the instruments are not working properly and the panel doesn't work as usual. And second, the flight path is not correct. If you look in the rest of this video, the second and third part, there are many outside views of the helicopter. So these outside views were, except for screenshots, they were taken with replay function. And if you look carefully, you are going to see that at some times the angular velocity has some discontinuity, or the helicopter ground speed has some discontinuity too. This is noticeable. So if you're careful, you will see that. And this doesn't reflect the exact helicopter movements. So you wouldn't have the proper sensations that you have now being on my side in this cockpit. So this is why I chose to do live recording, even though it is more difficult and has an impact on frame rate, which forces me to use lower details and lower resolution. Okay, so now preparing to land on this hospital platform, which is probably the most difficult part of this video, because there is some kind of surprising effect at first when you don't expect it. When I'm doing the flight this way, the main rotor is compensating the helicopter weight, the main rotor rotation, which causes a wind flow, etc., airflow, etc. But this airflow, which goes from main rotor in the downwards direction, when you arrive over the platform, it does some air cushion effect that makes the helicopter lift, suddenly lift, as soon as you pass over the platform. So it's not very easy when you arrive horizontally, and at some point the helicopter lifts suddenly, and it's a bit often difficult to recover decently from this situation. So if you arrive from upwards, from top, you don't have this very noticeable normally, but it's not very easy because you don't see under your feet, except if you have some way of looking downwards. I don't have this way, so it's difficult. And if you arrive from if you arrive horizontally, then you have this air cushion effect that makes the landing a bit tricky. But it's a good exercise, and if you manage to do it properly, you'll be probably better at all landings, and you can try more difficult things like landing on lighthouses, which are very, very small. So I'm taking the opportunity of this little moment on ground to show you the outside of the helicopter. It's a beautiful livery from the government of South Australia, made, if I'm to believe aircraft help, by Michael Habata, which has done a lot of work on this helicopter. So it's really beautiful work, but apparently it was not so easy to do. You can have a look in the help menu, in the helicopter specific menu, EC130B4, which is at the right of the flight gear menus. We are going to see it at the end of the video. So I'm going to mention another thing that has a link with this livery. So the instrument that is now under the mouse, at the top on the instrument panel, with the horizontal and vertical lines crossing at a right angle, is called Ground Speed and Drift Indicator, abbreviated GSDI. So this instrument normally is not activated when you choose this livery for the helicopter. I suppose that the helicopter they use in South Australia for fire and emergency situations maybe is not equipped with this instrument in standards. I suppose this is the reason. Anyway, you can add it yourself easily after choosing the livery, either by using the Alt-G shortcut, which is easy to remember because the instrument is Ground Speed and Drift Indicator, GSDI, or by choosing by checking the appropriate checkbox in the helicopter specific menu EC130B4, then you choose configuration, the configuration entry of the menu where you have livery, payload and other options for the helicopter, and then you can check the GSDI checkbox to have the instrument installed. You can only do this some options can only be done on ground, like adding floats to land on water, but I believe this one can be toggled in air, at least for now. Maybe this is a tiny bug. Anyway, this instrument tells you whether you're drifting forward or backward. This is what you can read from the horizontal line. And whether also you're drifting leftward or rightward. This is what the vertical line is telling you. So it's pretty useful for takeoffs and landings, in order not to move too much horizontally, not to bump into buildings, into trees, into fences, etc. However, you can do without this instrument by watching closely the scenery. If you closely watch the ground and everything that you can see through your cockpit glass, you can deduce how you're going to drift in the next few milliseconds, or this is a tenth of seconds, let's say. And if you are watching closely enough, you can land correctly without the instrument too. It's just I'd say it's a different matter of it's a matter of habit. Currently, I'm more used to watch the instrument, but you can do it without. So now, since we have a few minutes left before the end of this little tour in the airport, I'm going to explain a bit my setup for flying helicopters in flight here. So the good thing about this setup is that it's cheap and it works. Because if you looked at the beginning of the video, when I showed the interior of the helicopter, you saw that the pilot has rudder pedals that are activated by the feet. These rudder pedals control the tail rotor, which is used to control the rotation around the vertical axis. This rotation is called yaw, Y-A-W. So, normally you would need rudder pedals or something equivalent to control this rotation, which is necessary, otherwise you don't manage to fly. Since I don't have rudder pedals, I'm using some alternative mechanism, which is easy to be in flight gear because joystick bindings and mouse bindings and keyboard bindings are very customizable. So the setup I'm using is simply to use a mouse in left hand and cheap joystick in right hand. I say cheap because the only thing I need for this joystick is one axis. I'm using the left-right movements of the joysticks and nothing more. So this left-right movement corresponds to what the pilot would do with the pedals. So in flight gear you have to bind it to the rudder control in order to control the helicopter. So you can bind the left-right axis to rudder. You should, if you want to do the same as me at least, make sure the up-down axis does nothing to avoid disturbing the flight. And then you can use joystick buttons if you wish. I use a button to make sure the collective is completely cut when I'm on ground and I want to make sure that I'm not going to climb inadvertently. But this is completely optional. I can Casco Collective in a different way, which I'm going to explain. So Collective, I believe I didn't explain, maybe at the beginning, but anyway, Collective is the helicopter control that allows you to climb or descend. And Cyclic is the other helicopter control. So Cyclic allows you to control pitch and roll, a bit like the stick in a plane. Or the yoke in a big plane, in an airliner. So, I'm using this joystick in the right hand to control rudder, and I'm using the mouse in left hand to control pitch and roll, so the cyclic for helicopters. So this corresponds to up, down, left, right movements of the mouse, and I use the wheel mouse to control the collective, which in FlightGear correspond to the throttle axis. So I can control a throttle in a plane with the mouse wheel the same way. So this mouse wheel allows me to rise, to gain altitude, and to descend. One thing important to be aware of, and I give you a tip to solve the problem, is that this throttle axis I have found is more sensitive, much more sensitive in this helicopter, and maybe in other helicopters. I have not tried enough to be to be able to let's say make a sure claim. So the throttle axis for helicopters, which is controlling collective, is very, very sensitive in this model, at least. Much more sensitive than with planes. Something like 10 times more sensitive, or more sensitive, or something like that. Therefore, I use a little trick to adapt the flight gear settings depending on whether I'm flying this a helicopter or a plane. So I'm going to quickly explain how this works. I'm using the FFGo flight gear launcher, and this flight gear launcher, which is written in Python, allows you to conditionally pass arbitrary options to flight gear, to the FGFS executable, to be precise. So you can arbitrarily pass any flight gear option depending on various conditions, such as the aircraft you chose, or the airport you're starting at, or the scenarios you have enabled, or many parking position you have chosen, various parameters that can be chosen in the FFGo interface, or FGo, which is the same for this point. So depending on all these parameters, you can describe in the FFGo configuration which options flight gear is going to receive. So using this mechanism, FFGo automatically sets a property, which a custom property of mine, which starts with my name to avoid polluting the interfering with the flight gear namespace, standard namespace, let's say. So when I start with a helicopter, a special property is set to a value that corresponds to the sensitivity I need for this helicopter. And when I start a plane, FFGo automatically omits the property, which then has its default value, which I use for planes. And my custom mouse binding for the mouse wheel uses the value of this property to adapt the sensitivity and react to mouse wheel movements and translate them into throttle increases or decreases. So this is basically how it works. To avoid having to change files every time I want to change between a helicopter and a plane, or this helicopter and another helicopter, or things like that. Everything is done because thanks to this FFGo conditional configuration possibilities, which are very powerful. And then going through FlightGear properties, which can be read from nasal bindings, which can be used for mouse, joystick, and keyboard bindings. Another interesting thing in my setup, if you don't know it, is what I'm going to explain now. So I have modified a bunch of files, mainly XML files, from the FG data package in order to have keyboard shortcuts or customizable persistent views that can be recalled with Ctrl F1, Ctrl F2, Ctrl F3 and saved with Windows F1, Windows F2, Windows F3, etc. where Windows is the logo key. So I have many patches like that on top of the FlightGear XML files. But I'm following the FlightGear Git version, so the XML files can change every time I do an update of the Git repository, the FlightGear FG data Git repository. So in order to avoid having to apply the patches repeatedly, which would be error prone and very annoying, the standard solution is to use git --rebase when updating git pull --rebase. But this way is not very convenient to modify patches that are not on top, and even less convenient to disable a temporarily disable a patch and then re-enable it, which is what I need for patches that are helicopter specific. So when I fly a plane, I have a series of patches that is applied, and when I fly a helicopter, I have a few more patches applied on top of the patch series I use for planes. So the software I'm using, which is called StGit, it's a Python software that works on top of a Git repository and allows you to work with the usual Git commands, but you have a few additional STG commands, STG being the StGit executable. So this StGit software allows you to easily manage patch series like that, to polish them, to refine them. The goal initially was to submit them to upstream like kernel, Linux kernel maintainers. So this is pretty solid software, and it makes it very easy to temporarily enable or disable a patch or a patch series, and also to edit a patch that is in the middle of a patch series, and to update for your repository to the latest revision, your branch, and automatically apply the patches on top of this branch and this updated branch, and solve the conflicts similarly as you do with Git. So StGit is very useful if you have a lot of customizations to your FlightGear data files. Unfortunately, the FGA add-on repository is not in Git, it's in subversion, so I don't have such a convenient mechanism. However, there is a fork of this repository which is based on Git, FG members, I believe it's called. So on a plane-by-plane basis where I need customizations, I download the Git clone of this of the plane, and then use StGit in this smaller Git repository, smaller than the big FG add-on SBN repository. Okay, I'm trying to land safely, reducing collective progressively, staying above the H marking, and now we can engage the helicopter automatic shutdown procedure with the Shift E, or you can find it in the helicopter menu, in the helicopter specific menu. I'm showing you now the instrument that shows the rotation speed of the main rotor, so RPM must be rotation per minute. When this rotation speed arrives at 170, the automatic shutdown procedure will engage the main rotor brake, so the rotation speed will lower much quicker, and the rotor will arrive at a halt. So we're going to watch this from outside, which will be more interesting, and at the same time we can admire again the beautiful modeling work done on this helicopter. The livery, the fan at the tail rotor, this is not a usual tail rotor. This is supposed to be more silent and secure with respect to shocks than traditional rotors. So I read that this helicopter is used in towns and stuff like that because it's more silent because of this fan at the tail. So Max Rescue from the government of South Australia, used for fires, emergencies and stuff like that. You can see this information in the menu. I'm going to show you quickly. Very nice modeling work on the main rotor. Wow. You can see at the front of the helicopter the searchlight too. It's a left side of the pilot. Now you can see it now. On the right of the screen, but left of the pilot. So the rotor is going to halt. There we are. You have a flight report visible on one of the screens inside the cockpit, but you're going to see it later at the very end of the video. Because I'm too late now. When this message appears, it's already too late. So we were watching the outside, we can't watch the inside at the same time. So now the screens are off and you can't see the report anymore. But you will be able to see it at the end of the video. So I'm going to show you quickly the operator model info dialog, which explains a bit how this helicopter is used in real life, which I told you about fire and emergency, etc. in South Australia, and also some notes by the person who made the livery, Michael Habarta, MHAB. Now the FlightGear version I'm using is a development version, 3.5. Actually, what matters is the revision below, the big hexadecimal number. And the graphics OpenGL information is missing today, maybe because I switched resolution to record the video in lower resolution, I'm not sure. Anyway, it doesn't matter much. I'm going to show you also the rendering options I used for this flight. So not many things are turned on in order to keep the frame rate decent. Quality versus performance slider is at 1, which is not very high, but still decent. The graphics are decent, I think. I have left precipitation, 3D clouds, turned off AELS, etc. So this concludes my commentary of this flight. I hope it will have whetted your appetite and that you will want to try it by yourself. The next part of this video will show you mostly the same flight but from different viewpoints and in various weather conditions, as can be obtained with the flight recorder function of FlightGear. If you are tired of seeing the same airport, don't hang up now, but skip to the 50th minute or so of the video, because the last part shows you a very different area of the Innsbruck region, not exactly Innsbruck Airport. And I read that it is easy to miss, but worth seeing in my opinion. So I hope you will like it. And maybe, who knows, maybe we can meet on the multiplayer network one of these days. Bye bye!
Robots, I used to know.